Well, welcome to the third of the 2015-16 Clarence R. Noe Dean's Lecture Series. This has been going for some time. This is a 36 years of interdisciplinary lecture series has been going, showcasing the talent and depth of the faculty at Eureka College. Thanks to the generosity of the Noe family, represented here by Charlotte Noe on the 1, 2, 3, 4th row. It's actually begun by Dean Jerry D. Noe in 1980. And Dr. Noe is not here this evening, so we often recognize him. The series was created to stimulate discussion among the college faculty and to offer enrichment to students and friends of the college. In 1992, the Dean's Lecture Series was renamed in honor of the late Dr. Clarence R. Noe, who served as academic dean from 1955 to 1977. The series continues through gifts made by friends and family. Throughout the history of the series, special emphasis has been given to lecture topics reaching across academic disciplines. Tonight, this afternoon, we'll be hearing from Associate Professor of Communication, Dr. Amanda Frioli. Dr. Frioli joined Eureka College in 2008. She holds a master's degree in communication studies from Eastern Illinois University and doctorate in higher education administration from Illinois State. She is currently directing the Center for Public Speaking and Civil Discourse at Eureka College. She'll talk about her research this afternoon. Examines how faculty members in traditional face-to-face undergraduate classroom construct the first day of class to promote the behaviors of rapport, trust, and empathy. And there's some students to verify these things for you. She will first consider the implications of empathy and care as it relates to higher education, define community-centered learning, and discuss her methodology results and conclusions for the study. I actually have attended her class and can speak personally of her ability to do this. So for the topic, creating a community-centered learning environment, please welcome Dr. Amanda Frioli.
Good afternoon. Thank you for joining me and for the speaking invitation. Today I'd like to share some of my dissertation research with you, which discovers an emerging pedagogical style and explores how and why we should consider building communities in our classroom from the first day of class. I situated this study in a context very familiar to me, the classroom. But fear not if you have no intentions of becoming a professor or a teacher. While I'm using the classroom as a setting to explore this topic, building communities is something that's important for everyone. So you can apply this information to how you think about building communities in your organizations with the goal of building trust and rapport, both which encourage innovation and creativity. So first I'll tell you a little bit more about how my interest in this study developed, then I will share my theoretical frame, my method, and finally my conclusions. So first, a few research studies piqued my interest as I began to scratch the surface of this topic. And what I learned was that in 2011, Conrath, Singh, and O'Brien published their longitudinal findings from their 30 years of research on how college students self-report their level of empathy. So they used a well-established tool, the Interpersonal Reactivity Index, which is designed to measure perceived empathy. So for 30 years, these researchers would ask students questions like, and I'll give you three examples. The first, I often have tender, concerned feelings for people less fortunate than me. The second, when I see someone being taken advantage of, I feel kind of protective towards them. And the third question, I sometimes try to understand my friends better by imagining how things look like from their perspective. What they found was pretty alarming, that college students were disagreeing with these statements more and more each year. In fact, college students today self-report being more than 40% less empathetic than their peers in the 80s and 90s, with the sharpest decline happening after the year 2000. So there are several reasons that they think empathy is declining. And before we get there, let's quickly review what is empathy and why is it so important. So empathy is the ability to sense other people's emotions, coupled with the ability to imagine what someone else might be thinking or feeling. It's important because empathy allows us to build trust. It helps us understand how or why someone's reacting to situations, which helps us make better decisions. In short, a world without empathy would be chaotic and uncivilized. We probably wouldn't survive it. So there are three main reasons these researchers think empathy is declining, and I'll share those with you now. The first is the emergence of hyper-competitive situations and unrealistic reality television and our utter fascination with the genre of programming. I hope I have your favorite up there. The second, researchers alluded to the way we search for information online as a reason why we are less empathetic. So search engines are tailoring your news and ads to your preferences. The term filter bubble entered the public domain in 2011 when internet activist Eli Pariser, you may know his name as the CEO of MoveOn.org and Upworthy, he coined it to refer to the way that recommendation engines shield people from certain aspects of the real world. So he realized this phenomenon when he had two people Google Egypt into their search engine. And while one person's top 10 links were to travel information, someone else's top 10 links featured stories about the Arab Spring and Egyptian Revolution. So the scary part is that you have to opt out of this feature on your search engine. So unless you have already done so, your news is being selected for you based on what you like to hear about. So this is the filter bubble, being surrounded only by people you like and content you agree with. The obvious dangers are that it can polarize people and create harmful divisions in society. Finally, the researchers note our decline in empathy may be due to our culture's addiction of likes and instant gratification. So they suggest, as many other research studies have concluded, that social media platforms like Twitter, Facebook, Snapchat, and Instagram can negatively affect our perception of self and our perception of others. So we have a pretty big problem here, one that undoubtedly affects higher education, but also our global community. So now I'm going to switch gears and redirect us to another study, though, that demonstrates the direct value of care as it relates to college, and this one is much more positive. A recent study by the Gallup-Purdue Index found that if a student perceived that they had a professor who met these three criteria, who cared about them, made them excited about learning, and who encouraged them to pursue their dreams, their odds of being engaged at work and thriving in all aspects of their well-being more than doubled. That's pretty incredible. However, the caveat here is that of those 30,000 graduates, only 14% felt that they had a professor who met all three of these categories for them, who cared about them, made them excited about learning, and who encouraged them to share their dreams. And for a humble brag, this is something we know that we do really well here. Our NESE data, the National Survey for Student Engagement Data, consistently reports that we excel in this area. The Gallup Economy, however, completes the loop for us, though, by providing this data telling us why what we're doing in the classroom is so critical. So in a time where colleges and universities are increasingly more privatized, it's becoming even more important to articulate the lifetime value of higher education to our public and private audiences, and this research does just that. So what else does care have to do with learning in the classroom? Can care actually make us smarter? Several studies demonstrate that a significant relationship exists between face-to-face promotive interaction and learning. Promotive interaction means the students promote each other's classroom and their success in the classroom by sharing resources. So they help, support, encourage, and praise each other's efforts to learn. Another theory that supports face-to-face interaction and learning in the classroom is uncertainty reduction theory. And this is a core communication theory. It asserts that high levels of verbal and nonverbal communication reduce uncertainty while increasing communication intimacy. So last year, with the help of John Morris, who coordinated an opportunity sponsored by former college trustees Wayne Baum and John Beers, I was able to take a group of leadership minors to the Global Leadership Summit. And this conference featured several CEOs of Fortune 500 digital innovation companies, and Louis Solis, who is the current president of ImaginaTech North America, said it best when he said, "When you are in a zone of fear, you are not your best. Leaders change the fear zone to a trying zone." So this lesson is applicable to all facets of our lives, making the point that the quicker we build trust, the more comfortable we are to engage in risk-taking, which leads to transformational learning. So what makes the first day of class so special? Wilson and Wilson in 2007 established that the first day of class shares a positive relationship with student motivation, even linked to higher student grades at the end of the term. So this was the first experimental design on the first day of class, but a few others were making contributions to this pretty small body of literature as early as 1985. However, most studies focus on one of two areas: student satisfaction as it relates to the end of term evaluations, or student preferences for the first day of class, which include categories like learning about the professor and peers, course difficulty, the structure and content of the class, and the rules and expectations of the professor. So this is pretty new ground here. We know that first impressions are important, but little research is dedicated to one of the first and most impressionable encounters we have in our academic careers. And even less research exists on how professors intentionally think about the first day of class. So far, I've been building a rationale for why care and empathy are important to higher education, and I've introduced the context for this study. Now I'd like to share with you the lens that I used for thinking about community-centered learning in the classroom. Nell Nodding's care ethics is a widely popular theory in primary and secondary education, but less entrenched in higher education research. So there are two main tenets of her theory. The first is that care can be learned, and the second is that care is fundamental to education. This is important because there is a shift in academic communities about how we understand care. Care and empathy have long been considered inherent to feminine identities, but research now concludes that care and empathy are skills that can be taught through modeling and reflecting upon care in the classroom. So this theory connects care to deeper critical inquiry because of its emphasis on experiential learning and the importance of self-reflection. So there are four main components of her theory, and you'll see this emerge in my discussion about what these professors were doing on the first day of class to create caring, community-centered environments. And they're right here: modeling, dialogue, practice, and confirmation, and I'll keep referencing them. So the first is modeling, and what Nodding says about modeling is that as professors or teachers, we have the first opportunity to model what care looks like in the classroom. The second is dialogue, and she encourages us to engage in an active dialogue about what care means in the classroom from day one. The third is practice, and what goes along with practice is reflection. So with practice, she encourages both the students and professors alike to actively create opportunities to practice care in the classroom, and then reflect upon care in the classroom. And as one of the most influential voices on American education, John Dewey, once said, "We do not learn from experience. We learn from reflecting upon experience." And finally, confirmation. So teachers, who are traditionally the carer in this context, and then the students, who are the cared for in this context, must then play an active role in confirming what they perceive to actually be care. So as we go forward, please keep in mind that this is the framework I use to think about this study. So now we'll dive into the problem, my research questions, and so forth, and then I will talk about my methodology and conclusions. So the purpose of this study is to examine how undergraduate instructors who value a community-centered pedagogy construct the first day of class to promote the behaviors of empathy, trust, and care. My problem is that most studies on the first day of class are quantitative and measure student satisfaction. And while student satisfaction is important, it doesn't tell us much about cognitive learning. So the meme in the upper right-hand corner was a popular one that I kept stumbling on when I was researching the first day of class. And I think it echoes the public perception that the first day of class should be quick and to the point, cut to the chase. And I even hear people reference and call it syllabus day, right? So she's distraught from having to go over more than the syllabus. So what I wanted to know more specifically were these four questions. These are my research questions. So the first is, what do professors actually do on the first day to establish rapport and trust in their classrooms? What motivates them? How do they perceive their role in the classroom? And then finally, how do they reflect upon the first day of class? And I'll actually touch a little bit on some of those informal assessment practices that, that they were talking about. I'll focus mostly on the first question today, because I think this has the most practical takeaways for a broader audience. And in fact, you can even think about interchanging this language at points with what do leaders do during those initial encounters to establish rapport and trust? I think you will find a lot of parallels there that you could take to student organizations and the like. All right, so my method and design. So this was a qualitative exploratory study that identified professors who teach at least one undergraduate class at a relatively large public university with about 25,000 students. And my recruitment letter explicitly requested participants who wanted to reflect upon care in the classroom. So I identified these instructors through two means. First, I emailed them through the University Center for Teaching and Listserv, and this is a voluntary email list, so you only get emails if you sign up and you want emails from the Teaching and Learning Listserv. I also recruited people through the university's annual kickoff conference, which is a teaching and learning conference they have at the beginning of the year. So this was a group of highly reflective teachers who are already giving quite a bit of consideration to building rapport with their students from day one. A little bit about my participants. So there were 14 participants, and all taught at least one 100 level or 200 level undergraduate course. And because I was interested in community building, I didn't want to observe classrooms where communities had already been formed, which is more common in an upper level classroom. So 10 of these faculty members were full-time tenure track faculty. 3 were full-time employees with part-time faculty duties, part-time administrative roles, and one of them was a part-time faculty member who'd been with the college for several years. And there was a pretty even split among men and women. There were 6 male participants and 8 women participants. So through interviews, observation, and an analysis of artifacts, and those artifacts included syllabi, websites, initial email encounters with students, handouts that they gave out on the first day, and the like, I explored ways that these professors construct a sense of community in their undergraduate classrooms. So finally, I also requested that each participant take a brief survey to determine the faculty members' teaching relevance. And this survey became a really important part to my research, and because it let me know how these professors saw their role in the classroom. And so I adapted these questions from Calkins and Seidler's 2011 research on teaching relevance. And this survey really helped me understand each instructor's perception of their teaching style. So we'll talk about that a little bit, and I'll give you a couple sample questions from this survey that I constructed for them. So before we go through some of these sample questions, I'll first give you a quick overview of the 4 most prominent teaching styles that we see in the literature. And so I relabeled these 4 teaching styles from Calkins and Seidler's research, who simply called these perception A, B, C, and D, and I recoded them teacher-centered, subject-centered, learner-centered, and the 4th style, which I'm calling community-centered. I think you'll see why I did that in a second here. So first we'll go through the 4 styles, and then we can start matching them up with the survey. The first is teacher-styled, or the teacher-centered style. So this is highly autocratic. Teacher transmits all the knowledge to the student, who is a passive participant in the process. This is how we often think about a traditional lecture hall experience. The next is subject-centered, and so we see this often in vocational programming, teaching the student to the profession or the trade that they're going to be entering, and so they're learning the skills of the professional in that field. The third is learner-centered style, and this learner-centered style is where most of the current literature is aimed. So this is the hot teaching style right now. It embraces the notion that different students learn in different ways and that teachers need to have a diverse methodologies to reach each of those individual students. The fourth, though, that I'm calling community-centered teaching is this. And what these authors say about community-centered teaching is that these professors aim to help their students actively reflect on how their beliefs and values affect their global community. So they aim to empower students to share in the construction of knowledge. And as one instructor put so well, she said, "I want students to be thinking about the judgments they make, the language they use, and the ideas and language they are exposed to, to subsequently question and value with evidence where ideas come from." So this teaching style feeds seamlessly into Baxter McGolda's 20-year longitudinal research on the foundational objective of higher education, and she says that's self-authorship. So it's not unlike when we look at Maslow's hierarchy of needs and self-actualization, and then when he redid that that pyramid and added transcendence here too, self-transcendence, so to connect beyond the ego and help others find self-fulfillment, right? So what she says about self-authorship is this: it's the internal capacity to define one's beliefs, identity, and social relations and answer these three questions. How do I know? Who am I? And how do I want to construct relationships with others? So now we'll go through the survey and you can probably start to map which ones are more teacher-centered, subject-centered, community-centered, and learner-centered responses. So the first question, I hope that by the end of my course, students A, learn course content in order to pass exams or complete course requirements. Are you seeing which teaching style this lines most closely with? Does anyone want to bravely, want to go for it, Andy? Yeah, you got it. All right, A plus. Okay, so the next one, grapple with and solve real-world problems and to use skills of a professional to appreciate that there is not one fixed idea or perspective. Do you know which one this lines up with? Kaylee, I see you mouthing it, maybe. Oh, close. We'll give it subject-centered, and this is why. That's okay. Because of the language here, to use the skills of a professional to appreciate there's not this one fixed idea. So this one focuses a little bit more, but you can see that it's already growing. It's extending past the teacher-centered. So good. The third, learn to get at the nature of an ill-structured problem following a full, rich process of critical and reflective inquiry. This is where most of the literature is aimed right now, telling us that this is learner-centered. By now, you've probably figured out they're in order, right? So the last one is community-centered. Evaluate questions and problems holistically and develop in a way that asks them to reflect on what it means to be a productive citizen and part of society. So you see, again, that intentionality in the language of thinking about it as that student's role in their global community then as well. And the next go in the same order, where it's teacher-centered, subject-centered, learner-centered, and community-centered. So my understanding of teaching relevance, why I teach, is best understood by the following statement. A, students need to acquire teacher's content knowledge because the teacher knows it's valuable information. So you see this align closest with teacher-centered again. Students need to learn key concepts and or skills for practical or professional purposes. The language of subject-centered is certainly highlighted here. The third, and again, they develop on each other, right? So students need to develop the ethos of professionals in their field. That is more learner-centered. And then finally, we go one step further. Students need to now evaluate, make reflective decisions, and value and internalize professional ideas and concepts. This most closely aligns with community-centered. So we'll reflect on this in just a second here. So here are the survey results. And I want to be clear that this only paints half the picture. This is just how the professors saw themselves, right? So this was their perception of their teaching. And of the 14 faculty surveyed, four identified as subject-centered. The majority identified as learner-centered, 7, and 3 identified as community-centered. And having most of them identify with learner-centered really didn't surprise me, because this just meant they're good readers. They're actively engaged in the current literature of where we're at and what we're promoting right now, and that is predominantly learner-centered style. 3, though, answered community-centered across the board. I mean, they fell off the chart, and I became really interested in what they were doing in the classroom, because there were a lot of very unique parallels there. And for my discussion for today, I'm going to be focusing mostly on what these community-centered and those in the learner-centered category who were answering quite a few of community-centered ways, what they were doing in the classroom. So now we get into the good stuff, the discussion. So there are 6 action items that I'll discuss, but again, this isn't an exhaustive list. So what were these professors doing to create rapport and trust on the first day of class in their classrooms? And the first is learning students' names. And I know that seems obvious, but this was a really surprising finding in my research. All 14 professors, when asked, said, of course learning students' names is important. But then when I pressed them, only 4 of the 14 admitted to doing it every single semester, every single classroom, every single time, and being a large proponent for this process. Of the 10 who didn't, however, all gave very elaborate, detailed, just guilt-ridden excuses for why they didn't do this. And it might range from, having trouble because of their age, because of their workload, their class size, or because simply they felt like they were bad at it. And I think this is important because it indicated that they didn't perceive this to be in their favor when they were conducting their own internal cost-benefit analysis. And that's not terribly shocking either, because there's not a whole lot of research that exists on why it's so critical to learn students' names from day one. However, one professor who did learn all of his students' names, he stated that he only committed to this practice after doing his own informal assessment here. And so he said that during his graduate assistantship, and this was during his doctoral work, he asked one of his friends who was known by students and faculty to be this incredibly engaging and thoughtful instructor, and he taught primarily in lecture halls, so that's also pretty surprising. But he asked if he could sit in one of his classes, and he said that this was just an absolute game changer for him. Because this professor was calling on students by names, he knew all of their names in this lecture hall, and he said that this wonderful thing was happening. He said the students were not only interacting with the teacher, but they were challenging and supporting each other and engaging in this really meaningful dialogue, even kidding around with one another, and clearly had established this pretty meaningful rapport. And he said after this experience, he no longer had an excuse not to learn the 30 or so names in his classroom. And he really attributes a lot of his success in the classroom to this one behavioral change. So the second thing these professors were doing is that they legitimized time spent in building relations of care and trust. So these professors spent a great deal of the first day of class discussing identity. And for example, a political science professor who was teaching a women's studies class, he actively involved his students immediately in a dialogue about the privileges of being a man teaching a women's studies class. And so he first initialized dialogue by contextualizing the issues of femininity and masculinity by discussing the research of his female colleague on issues that she and other women face in higher education, such as pay inequity, issues of not stopping the tenure dot clock for maternity care and leave, and even some of the less obvious inequities, like not being addressed by their title as doctor and being called by their first name more frequently. So we then asked students to share personal stories of their initial perceptions of gender, which led to these pretty intimate accounts of when the student first realized what it meant to be a man or a woman. So they were telling a lot of personal stories about their families too here. But most shockingly to me was when a male student interrupted a female student, and the professor immediately used that as a teachable moment and brought up data saying that this happens more frequently to women than it does the other way around. And so this student kind of stopped dead in his tracks and didn't immediately apologize. But by the end of class, he had this really wonderfully reflective moment, and he apologized to his female colleague, and the day went on. They were over it. So I really want to show you again Nell Nodding's care ethics in practice here, because this was a great opportunity where I saw all four components very literally too on the first day of class. So first, he was modeling this behavior. So not only was he emphasizing gender inequity issues from day one and saying that this is important and going to be a theme that we continue to discuss when we talk about women in politics, but his general demeanor, you know, he was asking students to share information about themselves. He was learning their names as they were commenting. He would ask them to repeat their names and so forth. And he was smiling. He just had a friendly demeanor about him. The second is dialogue. So he engaged these students in a dialogue about care and the implications of inequity from day one. Those are pretty challenging subjects to talk about on day one. The third is practice and reflection. And so he had students share stories about how they understood gender for the first time and what it meant to be a man and a woman. So they were also practicing reading each other's nonverbal behaviors of what's appropriate dialogue, is it okay for me to be more vulnerable, how are my other peers then reacting to my comments and so forth. So that was really important for the practice and reflection part. And then finally, confirmation. And so what we saw here is that one student apologized, the other student accepted, and life went on. It was beautiful. Okay, so I'm going to give you one more example of a professor who legitimized time spent in building relationships in the classroom a little bit differently. And this was a sociology professor who taught a global family issues course that focused primarily on the perspectives of children. So she required that each student come to the front of the class and share one of their peaks and valleys of their adolescence. Just let that soak in for a minute. So that could be a really embarrassing thing to do, right? And she was certainly counting on them to be pretty vulnerable with that experience. So she went first and stood in front of the classroom, and she shared the obviously painful passing of her mother when she was 10 years old. And she was sharing how she felt like an outsider because she didn't have a mother to help her navigate slumber parties, making friends, puberty, and those other rites of passages that accompany girlhood and childhood. And then other students came up, and this was a class about 30, and then they were sharing their peaks and valleys as well. And this was a pretty incredible experience that I'd also like to highlight Nell Nodding's four components of care ethics all in one day of class on the first day. And so again, those are modeling, dialogue, practice and reflection, and confirmation. And so she modeled this behavior by going first, right, and demonstrating that she was open to being vulnerable from the first day of class as well with her students. The second is dialogue. She engaged students in a dialogue about having us reflect upon our peaks and valleys and what we found challenging when we were younger. She did include me on that activity, so I'm using we in a very literal way. So she also practiced. So she had students practicing being vulnerable and demonstrating care as an audience member. And also she encouraged the reflection part because she asked students to think about issues that other kids around the globe might be experiencing. So that fed into her lesson plan too. And then finally, confirmation, because students had to then assess and adjust their message based on the nonverbal and verbal feedback that they were getting from their community members, from their classroom. And I thought that this was really an important takeaway, too, because the stories were getting, the students were taking more and more risks as those stories went on. They were becoming more and more valuable, too, and just really enriched the dialogue because students were feeling more and more comfortable, and she was establishing trust as she went on that day. The third is helping students think of the class as theirs. So an education professor made it clear to his students on day one, he said that you're an essential part of the classroom and I don't finish constructing the syllabus until we have a conversation about how you like to learn. So he gave students, and these were pretty fixed alternatives, and he said that he has an idea of where this activity is going to go, so it doesn't totally leave him, you know, scrambling in the last couple minutes to finish the syllabus. But he asks them, how do you want to learn? And then he'll give them a couple options between different paper projects, group projects, and so forth. So he has that discussion with them. Something else some of these professors did is that they offered an experiential learning component from day one, which then links it to, again, that kind of global community and thinking about what we're doing in here and how it affects our community at large. But they would do this through a series of options. So then these students, could choose which organization they wanted to partner with for the semester, for example, and had some self-authorship in that decision. And then fourth, So the fourth thing that these professors were doing is that they explored the subject with students. And with is the operational word here. So these professors would engage in this very inclusive we language. So they would say things like, we will learn, we will explore together, and so forth. And what I thought was so interesting is that these community-centered professors all had a very weird welcome letter on the front page of their syllabus. I'd never seen anything like it. And it was written just like a letter that you would receive in the mail. So it said, dear students, I want to tell you about how excited I am to work with you this semester and the things that we're going to do and that I'm here for you and so forth. So it was this welcome letter that was written in the effort to generate inclusivity. And then they would sign it, you know, with their name. So fifth, these professors also encouraged group learning on the first day. So almost all the professors encouraged students to get into small groups and learn about their community members at some point. And this was done through, you know, various means, through interview exercises, group problem solving activities and the like. But takeaway here is that these were intentional activities focused on building a very specific community that was focused on thinking about the subject matter that they had in mind. And then finally, they also engaged in a dialogue regarding course objectives. And I'll actually reference group learning here too. I saw a professor do this in a really interesting way. This was a takeaway for me because I totally admit that in the past, I've kind of thrown away the course objectives on day one. Maybe I tell students to read them on their own. Maybe I'll go through it in a PowerPoint on the day one, but I want to get to other stuff and I know the objectives, right? So this was an incredible takeaway for me, though. One professor who was a different education professor, she broke her students up into groups and gave them each an objective and then said, okay, so she had six objectives, six groups with about five students per group. And she said, I really want you to unpack the language here. So I really want you to think about why would I write this objective and so forth. And she spent a good deal of her first day just talking about the intentionality and the direction that they were going to go. And then she said, after you unpack what this means, I want you then to tell me, what do you already know about, at this point in your career, and what do you need to know about this subject still? So where are the holes? And this was really crucial for me because, again, this was creating a pretty vulnerable moment for students to now say what they don't know to a bunch of strangers. Nobody wants to admit that. And something really unique was happening here. When the students started to self-report back to the classroom, they had this confidence to reframe what they didn't know and started saying things like, I'm excited to learn more about A, B, and C. And all of the groups were doing that. So it was contagious that there was this very, you know, that she created and she reframed something that could be intimidating into something that was really positive and exciting. So I thought that was a pretty brilliant technique. So here are six, and on another day, I would love to tell you a couple more, answer some of the questions about my other questions. But for now, I'm going to begin to wrap up. And so, to review, this study has helped me reflect upon my teaching journey and informs the decisions I make in my classes because it's helped me draw these very specific conclusions between care and learning. And because motivation is a core factor in student engagement, it's important to continue to explore the relationship between student motivation and persistence as it relates to the classroom. So as for future research, and I've been thinking about this a lot, there's a lot of directions and projects that I'm interested in thinking about. And one of them might be, conducting a longitudinal study on how our first impressions influence community building. But I'm also interested in maybe venturing into an experimental design related to community-centered learning, risk-taking, and how that relates to cognitive learning as well. So we'll see. I'd like to thank a lot of people today. So first, I'd like to thank Dr. Jerry McCoy and the late Dr. Clarence Noe for establishing this series. Next, I am grateful for the participants in my pilot study. And in my pilot study, I observed our esteemed faculty in the math and science division. And while I can't name them or risk violating the terms of my IRB, I was absolutely blown away by the many ways these professors were creating communities in their spaces. I'd also like to make a shout out to the School of Education at ISU and to my dissertation committee, who are comprised of colleagues that I value as community-centered teachers. And each of these members were selected in part because I really valued them as a teacher first. Lance was one of my very first communication professors when I was a wee little old freshman at Illinois State University in the communication department. So this was a really cool opportunity for me to directly reflect upon how I learn and teach in my research. And then finally, I get to work with a lot of great people. I'd like to thank my colleagues who are not only the best and brightest in their fields, but who are truly a group that values and excels at creating engaging learning opportunities. So I feel so lucky that I get to teach and learn with you. And then last but not least, our students, who aren't often afraid to take risks and who make what we do all worthwhile. Thank you. Does anyone have any questions, comments? Hi, Sarah. And I could see this could be a really intimidating question and answer period for me. A lot of holes. It's made it a lot more nerve-wracking and a more intense experience because I know how important it is. So I do think about it, and I really think about what we're going to do and how we're going to do it. One thing that I do, I now go through all of my students' names, so I have, and I think it's really important that to make an attempt to pronounce students' names correctly and so forth. And those little things help create this more inclusive environment because it feels like we already know each other. The other thing that I'm doing now much more intentionally is spending a little time on the objectives, but then I'm now following through with that at the end of the semester and going back through those objectives to say, did we meet this? Did we not meet this? And sometimes I pat myself on the back and I say, we did it, folks. But there are other times that I realize, you know, we really could have spent more time on, you know, the fifth objective. And so I'll make my note on that syllabus because I keep the same syllabus in each folder all year long. And then the next time I'm starting to think about the class again, I have my notes right there to start, reconstructing it in that way. So those are a few ways. Yes, hi, Harry.
Do you think that there is enough commonality in teaching regardless of discipline, or do you think there will be great differences in the best way to get the course? So, for instance, if you have a math course, mm-hmm.
I'm so glad that you asked that, because that was why I conducted a pilot study. I didn't necessarily have to, but and I conducted it with a program that I'm pretty unfamiliar with, the division that is science and the math and science division. And when I say that I was blown away by some of the things that they were doing in the classroom, I absolutely mean that. And when I go to conferences, I actually share this tip for assessment practices, to be thinking about how you coordinate those evaluation opportunities. Because I think that everyone still, the whole community at large still finds having somebody else, another professor, come into your classroom slightly invasive, a little nerve-wracking of an experience. And I encourage them to not focus on the content and go to somebody outside of their division so that they can just focus then on the pedagogy, and they can just focus on the things about how they're creating rapport, how they're thinking about trust, what do they do at the beginning of the class, are they standing up, are they sitting, do they, you know, talk about what was on television last night, do they bring up something in the news, and all of those just little nonverbal and verbal cues which are rich with meaning. And so that was something that I just thought was so cool, and something I wouldn't have done if I hadn't, and in my pilot, ISU had said specifically, we need you to be in a division far removed from your own, you know, and I know we're a small campus, but that's what happened, and it really was. There are still things that I reflect on our math teachers and our biology teachers doing at this college that I took with me and I put in my backpack. So I do think that there are very common threads. And then just to note these, you know, what I'm labeling are those who self-identified as community-centered professors were in very different divisions. So I had people from the departments, you know, ranged from education to communication to math, to political science, history, and I know I'm leaving a couple out there, but they were all across the campus too, so, and these professors had these common threads. I did expect that that might be the case though, that it would be like all communication professors are doing this, or all education professors, and that wasn't how it happened. So that was a good learning experience for me. Yes, hi, Renee, Dr. Mullen. You, I was just talking about you. No, I mean, no, not you. Mm-hmm. 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 Right. It is a balance, and I think those professors that I saw doing this best were able to strike that balance of saying, okay, well, this is how we're going to build a community and think about sociology. So I first want you to reflect on, you know, through your own lens of what your adolescent felt like and so forth, because now that I've opened you here, we can then switch the subject and start talking about, you know, students in a global community there. So I do think we have to strike a balance, and I think one way to do that is to, and we're already doing this on our syllabi with our objectives connected to the global community, or what sort of experiential learning opportunities are we having in the class, and just doing those little threads really add up, I think, across the continuum, across the semester. But I think my argument would be is that if possible, to be spending a little bit more time, especially on that first day, because that first day is so important. It predicts the student evaluation outcomes at the end of the year, so how students are going to evaluate the professor is linked to that first day time and time again. So if they felt that they had a positive experience, if they felt like they knew the people in their classroom, and they felt like they knew what was going on, and that they had some authorship, that was going to help on the other end. So those sorts of takeaways are critical, but I recognize that in my field, I have a little bit more of an advantage teaching human communication and intercultural communication in those classes that lend themselves to something like this, but it certainly wasn't limited. I saw professors doing this much better than I was, so there was certainly a lot that I could learn there too, so a balance. I hope I answered the question. Anne? Yeah.
Because we tie it to the value structure. And we talked about
That's exactly what I would love. I mean, that's the type of project that I would like to see next, because no one has done the second part yet. I mean, this is still really new. There's very little research, and we're just now connecting the dots as an academic community and putting those pieces together, so. I mean, that really is that, I mean, that's everyone's challenge, right? And I think that creating, I mean, there are two ways to look at or to kind of think about, or two camps of thinking about these students, these disengaged students, and we can only do so much, right? But one of those things that I at least attempt to do, and sometimes I succeed and sometimes I fail, is bringing those students in for one-on-one meetings. And then that's sometimes hard for those disengaged students, just to kind of entrap them. So if I can get them in the Bergu or something like that. And as soon as I start learning about their experiences, I find often a common thread might be that they're new to college. Their parents hadn't gone to college or something like that. And they're still just learning how to navigate. They're really intimidated to come to my office and kind of breaking down those barriers. But it's not foolproof. It's just not. But at least then I know that I've made some of those efforts, and I can sleep a little bit better. That's a good question, though, and one that we. Absolutely. Yeah. Yeah. Hi, Becca. This is what the professor did, yeah, it was wild. And that's why the other one who said, well, I teach classes of 30, which even for us, that seems large sometimes. You know, a lot of our classes are a little bit smaller than that. But he said, yeah, so he went through all of these techniques, he printed out all their names, and they do a lot of web CT, and they work a lot with an online learning system. So we would have the students then, you know, give him a little bit more information and tidbits and so forth. And what I suspect, because I did ask another faculty member who taught small group communication, and that was in a lecture hall of 200 students, and so she had other teachers in the class. I mean, it was wild. But then these little micro communities emerged. So, and she would know based on kind of like she would just be reading who students kind of liked, who played those maintenance roles of bringing a little humor, or lightening the tone, who was asking good questions. And so she said her technique was just to learn maybe 30 or 40 names, not to totally overwhelm herself, but she noticed that a community then, they felt more responsive, and she said that technique had worked for her too. But this other professor was not messing around. He really took it seriously to learn all of those students. And I think one way he might have thought about it too is that a lecture hall then, that would be maybe three assignments if you have 100 students or whatever. So the same professor would have 104 different classrooms, but I mean, am I saying that that's intense and it would be challenging to commit to? Absolutely, but pretty cool. And he did it because he saw the results. He firmly believed that this changed his teaching, or changed his learning, really, the learning in the classroom. I guess it's cookie time. Thank you.